Isang magandang hapon po sa inyong lahat. Kasama niyo po ako muli si Ella Marie Dimocolangan mula sa Dangerous Drugs Board to serve as the moderator of our webinar this afternoon. Bago po tayo magsimula, nais ko po munang batiin lahat ng mga nanonood, lahat ng ating participants. Magandang hapon po sa lahat ng kasama natin dito sa WebEx, pati na rin po ang nanonood sa atin sa pamamagitan ng ating Facebook live streaming. Ilang mga paalala lamang po bago tayo magsimula. Sa ating mga kasama dito sa WebEx, please ensure that your microphones are turned off, especially when someone else is speaking. To maximize the internet bandwidth, you may also turn off the video function. Para mai-record naman po namin ang inyong attendance, please type your names and organizations in the chat box. Sa mga nanonood naman po sa atin sa pamamagitan ng ating Facebook live streaming, maaari po ninyong i-share ang ating live video para naman ang inyong mga kaibigan ay matuto rin mula sa ating pag-uusapan this afternoon. Abangan nyo rin po ang ipopost na link sa ating Facebook comment section sa attendance form para po mai-record din po namin ang inyong mga attendance. Paalala po, maire-record lang po officially ang inyong attendance if you click the link to be posted in the comment section and answer the required information. So this afternoon, isa pong interesting topic ang ating pag-uusapan. We will tackle the impact of drug use to mental health. With the help of our speaker and of course the engagement of our participants, I am sure that this is going to be a productive discussion. Kaya naman po, simulan na po natin. To open our virtual discussion, we will be hearing a message from the Deputy Executive Director of the Dangerous Drugs Board. Please welcome Assistant Secretary Maria Belen Angelita V. Matibag.
Thank you, Ella. Magandang hapon po. Una sa lahat, gusto kong pasalamatan ang ating participants and viewers sa Cisco WebEx and Facebook Live sa pagkatangkilik sa ating webinar ngayong hapon. Salamat sa inyong oras at sa inyong pagnanais na matuto tungkol sa topic natin ngayon, the impact of drug use on mental health. Labis din kami nagpapasalamat sa ating resource speaker, si Dr. Benny Vicente, isang longtime friend mula pa nung siya ay direktor ng National Center for Mental Health sa Mandaluyong City, sa kanyang pagpapaunlak sa ating lahat ngayon. For some, the relationship of drug use to mental health can be compared to chicken and egg. Alam niyo ba yon? Matagal nang palaisipan sa atin kung ano ang nauna. Yung manok ba na ng itlog o yung itlog na napisa at lumaki ng isang manok. Pwede nating i-compare sa topic natin ngayon. Which happened first? A person gets addicted to drugs because of his mental problem, gaya ng depresyon, pagkadalisa, psychosis, o ng stigma na dulot nito, or is it because naging addict siya sa bawal na gamot, kaya siya nagkadiferensya sa pag-iisip? So meron pang follow-up question dyan. Maari bang ibalik sa orihinal na kalagayan ang pag-iisip na naapektuhan na ng droga? Or is the damage irreversible? Ano sa palagay nyo? Abangan natin ang maaaring mga kasagutan sa discussion ni Dr. Benny. The reason why we are so concerned about drug use and mental health is because we want to help drug abusers recover well enough to become drug-free, productive, and law-abiding citizens of our country. Thus, we need to address and recalibrate all the facets of a person affected by drug use. Simula pa ng katapusan ng Mayo, every other week, sinisikap ng ating Dangerous Drugs Board, Preventive Education, Training, and Information Division na magsagawa ng mga webinar tungkol sa drug abuse prevention and control. Hinihimok namin kayo ngayon na mag-suggest ng mga topics na gusto nyong talakayin natin upang makadagdag sa inyong kaalaman o makapagpaigting pa ng inyong mga kakayahan na maging kaagapay namin sa pagkataguyod ng mga pamayanang malaya at malayo sa droga. For as long as we will be able to invite experts like Doc Benny to discuss your suggested topics, we will gladly oblige. Mangyari lamang na mag-comment kayo sa FB page namin ng inyong mga suggestions for our future webinars. I hope that everyone will be able to take away valuable insights from this experience and be encouraged to continuously support the Dangerous Drugs Board and our partner agencies in the anti-drug campaign. Lagi ninyong tatandaan na ang kalusugan ng ating mga mamamayan, may pandemya man o wala, ay napakahalaga para sa amin. Ang isang malusog na bansa ay kaakibat ng kaunlaran, kapayapaan at kaginhawahan. Once again, thank you for joining us here today. May you stay safe and stay healthy. God bless us all. Maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat po, Asek Maria Belen Angelita V. Matibag. Ngayon, bago po tayo magtungo sa susunod na bahagi ng ating programa, nais ko po muna kayong anyayahan ang mga kasama natin dito sa WebEx para sa ating virtual photo session. Mainam na gawin na po natin ito ngayon para sa ating documentation. So may I please request everyone here on WebEx to please enable or turn on your video function. Paki-on po ang inyong mga video para maisama po kayo sa ating virtual photo session. Okay. Sige po, turn on your video po. Hintayin natin yung iba pa nating kasama. Okay, please hold your smiles po. Please hold your smiles. Alright, maaari na po nating i-turn off yung ating video function. Okay, so before I turn over the floor to our resource person, nais ko po muling ipaalala sa ating mga participants na siguruhin na naka-disable o naka-turn off o naka-mute ang inyong mga microphone. Habang nagpe-present po ang ating speaker, maaari na po ninyong ipadala ang inyong mga katanungan sa pamamagitan ng chat box dito sa WebEx o sa comment section ng Facebook at sisikapin po natin itong i-address mamaya sa ating open forum. Allow me now to give you a brief background on our speaker. He is a Career Executive Service Officer Rank 4 who earned his degree of Doctor of Medicine from the University of Santo Tomas in 1978 and Master in Hospital Administration from the University of the Philippines College of Public Health in 1994. He worked in different units and agencies of the government as psychiatrist. Some of these are the Philippine First Asylum Camp in Puerto Princesa City, Palawan, Community and Family Services International, Philippine Refugee Processing Center in Morong, Bataan, and Philippine Refugee Transit Center in Parañaque, Metro Manila. In 1991, he started working at the National Center for Mental Health. In 1998, he was appointed as the Medical Center Chief, a position he served until his retirement. As a professional psychiatrist, his expertise was tapped by various international government organizations by being a presenter, member, and delegate to different training programs and workshops in Thailand, Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, Mexico, Brunei Darussalam, China, Peru, Japan, and Switzerland, among others. He also wrote 19 research journals on mental health. Some of these have been presented in international platforms and were published in the Philippine Journal of Psychiatry. His works were recognized through awards and plaques of appreciation by distinguished schools, hospitals, and other related organizations. He may be retired from the National Center for Mental Health, but he is very much active as mental health lecturer and advocate. Friends, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our resource speaker, Dr. Bernardino Benny A. Vicente.
Yeah, pleasant good afternoon to everybody. Before going on to the topic natin ngayon, I'd like to thank DDB for allowing me to give a lecture on drugs, no, and especially yung on mental health. So our topic for today is the impact of drug use to mental health. No? So kanya lang, nilagyan ko ng konting talk on COVID. Kanya meron yung pictures natin, ang ganda ng COVID virus nandun. No? Okay. So let me go to the presentation proper. Next slide, please. this is how I'm going to present it. I'll be talking about some info on COVID and how it relates to mental health and substance abuse. And then I'll go on to define yung mental health and mental disorders, no? And then talk a little about the etiology of mental disorders and substance use disorder. And then try to define stress, its classification, sources, and then in particular, talk about what's happening now, in the pandemic, I coined the word COVID stress now. And then finally, the meat of the topic, the impact of drug use and mental health, And then substance-induced mental disorder, vis-a-vis or versus yung psychiatric comorbidity. And then we end with a question and answer portion. So next slide. So mag-start ako, Ang COVID kasi infection, it's like the flu. Only the difference is it's much severe, Ang flu mo, hindi usual yung nagkakaroon ka ng shortness of breath, not unless you get pneumonia. So it's very similar sa flu. You have fever, you have coughs, minsan you have body aches, Very similar, Next slide. So that's why usually kino-confer yung flu with the COVID kasi they're both a viral infection, And you have yung RO number, it's pronounced as R0, is a measure ng infectivity. So if you take a look at flu, 1.3 lang yung infectivity niya. So hindi siya nakaka-infect masyado ng maraming tao. Unlike COVID, the R0 number niya is 2 to 2.5. So mabilis siyang maka-infect, maraming na-infect. And then in terms of incubation period, ang flu mo, within 1 to 4 days, you have signs and symptoms of the flu. So hindi ka mahirapan ng contact tracing kasi chances are you'll know right away kung sino naka-infect sa'yo. Unlike in COVID, sometimes it's 14 days bago lumabas yung first symptom mo. So maraming asymptomatic na nakakahawa, And contact tracing becomes difficult. And this is what is more stressful, Kasi ang COVID-19, as much as 19% of the cases are hospitalized. And generally, ang reason for hospitalization is yung shortness of breath, which is not that prominent. Minsan wala sa flu, and only 2% are usually hospitalized. The case fatality rate is also one that is nakakatakot, and causes a lot of fear and anxiety, In the flu, it is less than 1% or less than 0.1%, while in COVID-19, it's about 4% ang average. So next slide. But basically, yung fatality rate, ang mga namamatay or nagiging fatalities are usually those already immunocompromised na yung problema. Yung immunity na is not that good anymore. So basically, ang madaling mahawa are the extremes of ages, the children, and then the elderly, The children, taas ang mortality rate, but they get infected, easily get infected. Pero in the elderly, mga senior citizen, once they get infected, mataas ang mortality rate, So people with other comorbid na illness, like for example, hypertension, diabetes, or if they have HIV AIDS, yan ang mga very high ang mortality rate, This includes also yung pregnant women. So next slide. Next slide will show you pag makita mo talaga na pag if you're old, 60 years old, senior citizen ka, to 80 years old, tumataas talaga from 3.6% ang mortality rate mo to as much as almost 15%, Next slide. Okay. And then this slide shows you that if you have pre-existing condition, heart disease, diabetes, chronic lung condition, high blood pressure, and even anemia, and cancer, tumataas yung mortality rate mo. Now, ang mga drug abusers natin, especially those that will use drugs, no, by inhaling them or snorting them or and then if they have other infections, no, as a result ng drug use, mataas din ang mortality rate nila, no. Next slide. Well, this is what we're almost the rest of the world is actually doing, itong ginagawa. We want to delay the epidemic, no? So you want the epidemic to be slow, no? Hindi mabilis ang rise ng infection so that the hospitals will be swamped with cases, no? Because if you delay yung flatten the curve or you delay yung peak, no? Hindi maswamp yung hospital and therefore the mortality rate is lowered, no? But the real objective pa rin is at the end is you increase the number of people getting infected then, no? Kasi in the long run, no, if you get about 40 to around 60% of the population infected with COVID and di sila namatay, nag-recover, no, you develop what is called yung herd immunity. Kakaroon ng herd immunity. So hanggat di pa lumalabas yung vaccine, that's one of the things that you want to happen for a community, mag-develop siya ng own immunity niya. Next slide. Well, this is what we're doing in physical distancing, no? Usually reduces the infection rate by as much as 75%. Next slide, no? This is also what we're doing, no? Yung mask, face mask. The next slide, no? So in some parts of the world, especially in Europe, matagal sila bago na realize that the face mask was very important. Unlike us in the Asian countries, no, nag-face mask na rin tayo right away, no? So nakatulong to ng sto. The other strategy natin, of course, is this one. Next slide. Hand washing. Next slide to. Okay. And then next slide, no, would be, this is what we should be doing. Di natin masyadong ginagawa ito, yung testing, no? Because the COVID, no, invisible yan eh. Our enemy is invisible eh. The only way to make it visible and know where they are, no, it's by a lot of testing, no. Dito medyo kulang tayo, I think, no. Next slide. Now, even if there is this infection, there's some hope, no. So there are treatment that are now coming up na maganda naman, no. So yung una nang lumabas the treatment was yung anti-malaria hydrochloroquine and azithromycin. But later studies find out na 50-50 ka lang dyan, eh. hindi that well, no. Well, right now the treatment is antiviral, yung remdesivir, no. Clinically significant, it can reduce yung days mo in the hospital from 15 days to 11 days, no. Malaking bagay yan. And even the mortality rate from 11 to 8% ay bababa niya, no. Tayo meron din yung convalescent plasma therapy. We also do that here in the Philippines na, no. What we're hoping is that lumabas na yung vaccine. There are many promising vaccines. About 170 vaccines are being developed worldwide, no. I think there are four of them that are very promising, no. I think the one being made by Moderna, no, is being tried already here in the Philippines. Sinusubukan na. But yung Oxford vaccine, the one that is in UK and made by AstraZeneca, no, it's supposed to come out by as early as September. And nasa phase 3 na sila. They're actually testing it on people, no? Thousands of people, no? So, next slide. So, yung COVID natin causes a lot of stress. I think walang tao na hindi tinamaan, na hindi naapektuhan ng fear and anxiety about COVID. Eh. Simply because hindi natin alam masyado what COVID is, no? So, the fear and worry about oneself, especially yung mahawa mo yung pamilya mo, mahawa mo yung nanay mo, tatay mo. So, this is very matingkad na matingkad to dun sa mga frontliners natin. The nurses and the doctors, no, na pagkataas ng duty nila, minsan di makauwi dahil takot sila baka mahawa nila yung pamilya nila. They can't even hug their children, no, pagdating nila, no. And yung COVID, it has changed a lot of things. Lahat yung schedule natin, sleeping, eating pattern, No, yung routine natin has been changed, work setup, no, has been changed, no. Talagang nabago lahat. And what is expected and what is happening right now, yung chronic health problems are worsening. Mental health conditions are also worsening. Marami tayong nakikita ngayon, nagpapanik, no? Nagde-generalized anxiety disorder, kakaroon ng depression, no? And sometimes yung iba, nag-flare up, nagre-relapse yung dating magaling na, nagre-relapse sila. And there is also expected increase. Hindi expected, it's also happening. Increased use ng alcohol, tobacco, and drugs, no? Ito yung effect ng COVID, no? Later on, di-discuss ko pa to. So next slide natin, I'll go now to a discussion of the definition of health. And I'll just read this. Health is not merely the absence of illness or disability, but actually a person's overall state of wellness, which includes not only his physical state, but his social and mental well-being as well. This is a definition of the WHO since 1946. Hindi na bago yan up to now. Only in 2013, they added a statement during the 66th World Health Assembly, no, a statement that says, there can be no health without mental health. Just to emphasize that mental health is part of that definition of health in general. So next slide. No. Well, the implication of this definition is that health is not static. No. Health is actually a spectrum. If you go down below, sa babang baba, you'll see that's what you don't want to happen, yung health mo leading to death, no? But meron kang mga stages yan eh. From death, no, you can be severely ill, you have mild sickness, or sometimes people do not know they're sick. They feel that magaling sila eh. Only to find out pagka nagkaroon ng laboratory, nagpa-laboratory testing, no, there are some sickness. Or sometimes, incidentally, pag nagka-CT scan, no, may nakitang mga tumor, no. Okay. And then there is also wala talagang sickness, or there is freedom from sickness. Yan ang good health, no. Kung baga meron kang good health, you want a better health and best health. Parang laro ata yun, eh. Good, better, best, no. Okay? So it means that you can go beyond simply being not having a sickness to having better health and the best health possible. Yung best health possible is called positive health. No? And you want to try to achieve that kasi it will predict longer life, no? Longevity. And then at the same time, it will mean kung if you have positive health, less ang health cost mo. And then better mental health in aging. And better prognosis when illness strike, especially pag may COVID. So yun ang labanan ngayon is making yung immunity mo good eh, yung health mo good, so that when you get sick or at least when you get in contact with COVID, hindi ka ma-infect. Or when you get sick, no, yung outcome ng sickness mo is not going to be fatal or not going to be severe. So next slide. Next slide, ganun din. In substance abuse, no, spectrum din yan. Hindi rin yan static yan. So we all know that drug users may oscillate from recreational or occasional user to heavy social using to regular, tas babalik na instrumental. And then some are really become dependent, na nagiging addict na sila, and even develop psychosis, and some of them die. On the other end naman, on the positive end, no, you don't stop at no drug use, no. And what you want sana is again positive health, no, wherein meron kang resiliency. So you don't stop at no drug use, or you don't stop your campaign by simply saying to children, school, say no to drug. You actually, for them to become resilient, you tell them how, or you teach them how to say no to drugs, no? Para hindi lang no to drugs, no? Okay, no drug use. So there are techniques which can build resiliency of people to become more resistant, no, to drug abuse, no. So promotive and preventive strategies are very important, no. Okay, next slide. Well, now mental health. What is mental health? I'll just read this. This is a WHO definition: a state of well-being in which the individual realizes his or her own abilities, can cope with the normal stresses of life, can work productively and fruitfully, and is able to make a contribution to his or her community. Again, mayroong additional statement ng WHO: mental health is not just the absence of mental illness. And this is a 2001 definition, no? Next slide. I think this is a simpler definition. The next slide, please. Next slide. Okay. So, you say you have mental health kung successful ang performance ng mental function mo. As in general, tatlo yung mental function na to, for simplicity sake. Yung thinking mo, no? Functioning well ka, yung feeling mo, and then the control ng behavior. So if you have successful performance of this mental function, it will lead to productive activity, sabihin, makakapagtrabaho ka. It will lead to fulfilling relationship with yourself, sa sarili. Mamahalin mo yung sarili mo, no? You love yourself, you care for yourself, meron ka self-care, you spend time for leisure, no? And then fulfilling relationship with others, meaning to say, may love life ka, no? And in love life mo will mean love relationship with parents, relationship with husband, relationship with wife, relationship with children, relationship with kumare, relationship with your friends in your work, no? Yan ang mga relationship. And even relationship with God. No? And then for children, it's even relationship with their pet. No? And as a result of, again, successful performance, you're able to cope with the day-to-day changes. Yung mga normal stressors of life, nakakope ka. And on top of that, cope with adversities. Ibig sabihin, may disaster, merong crisis, may pandemic, you're even able to cope with it. Now, the two pies on the right, no, yan yung, that's a way of presenting life. No? Life mo is made up of two pie. One is yung waking life mo, and the other pie, the smaller pie, is the life you have spent in bed. No? And I always say, you only do three things in bed, no? In life mo, in bed, no? And that is you sleep, have sex, and sex again. Yun lang. Tatlong bagay lang. Tandaan nyo yun. Only three. No? Next slide. Mahirap magbigay ng joke kasi minsan hindi mo nakikita yung mga ano mo eh. Mga participants mo. Ano reaction. No? Okay. Well, now we talk about mental and behavioral disorder. And basically, yung three things, yung three mental function mo, pag na-alter yan, there is alteration in thinking, clinically, kitang-kita mo, or alteration sa mood, no? Masyadong naging malungkot na malungkot siya, no? O kaya inappropriately na masayang-masaya, miski dapat malungkot, no? And yung behavior niya, hindi makontrol. And it is associated with distress, and hindi na siya maka-function, hindi na siya makatrabaho. It's difficulty relationship, no? Then you call it a mental or behavioral disorder. So next slide, no? We'll show you yung concept. Next slide, please. So the concept of mental, no, back, one slide back. So the concept is clearly, next slide. Clearly, merong abnormal psychological or behavioral manifestation, meron siyang distress and or dysfunction, and sustained or recurring. Pag sinabing sustained, ibig sabihin, hindi yung nalungkot ka lang ngayon oras na to, tapos kanina, wala na. Sa depression, ang sustained, ibig sabihin, dalawang linggo mahigit, isang buwan, pirmi kang malungkot. Or kung recurring, if you lose consciousness once, it may not be labeled as a disorder, Pero kung nawawalan ka ng malay every now and then, it will be called by the neurologist as a epilepsy or seizure disorder. Kailangan recurring. Substance abuse is a recurring illness. Paulit-ulit yung behavior ng drug taking. No? Next slide. So here are examples ng mental disorders. No? So let's say for example, it's yung memory ang affected and the intellect. No? You can have disorders such as senile dementia, Alzheimer's disease, mental retardation. Or kung pagpalagay mo ang na-disturb is the thinking, no? You can have yung disorders such as what you call psychosis or schizophrenia. Kung naman emotion, you can have depression and the bipolar disorder, no? Eh kung behavior like substance abuse, yan dyan, disorders like ADHD and conduct disorders are listed there. So next slide. Ito naman yung common mental disorders. And this is the, from a WHO report, also 2001. No? So I just wanted to show you that here, it listed alcohol and selected drug disorder. Actually, SUD, substance use disorder, are also mental disorders. No? Kanya lang, pinaghihiwalay natin yan, but they're basically also mental disorder. Next slide. Now, ang usual na tanong, tinatanong sa mga psychiatrist sa atin, no? Na nasa field ng helping profession is, what cause mental disorder or what cause substance use disorder? No. And usually ang sagot natin parang sa Facebook tinanong yung civil status, complicated ang sagot, no? Ganun din. Here, it is complex. There is walang single etiologic factor or one reason lang. It is usually a complex interplay between the biological, social, and psychological factors, no? So, next slide. So, even substance use disorder, there is no single cause, no? Next slide. No? And because yung nature naman ng addiction din mo, yung expression niya iba-iba. Maraming the causes are many, the way it is expressed are many, yung side effects din niya marami rin, no? And it is usually unique to each individual. Kanya they say when you treat a substance use abuser or a drug addict, no? You should tailor fit yung treatment nung para sa pasyente mo. So next slide. So one way of explaining how to explain yung cause ng psychiatric illness and even drug abuse, no, is through the model ng biopsychosocial model. Pag sinabi mong biological factors, you're talking about yung heredity, no? So you may inherit the predisposition to depression. You may inherit the predisposition to becoming an alcoholic, no? So genetic factors yan. And then you also talk about neurochemical and neuroendocrine factors, no? These are your hormones, these will entail yung mga neurotransmitters in your brain. And when you talk about neurophysiology and neuropathological factors, this is usually anatomy, yung structure ng utak mo. And then, if you talk about psychological factors, social factors, ito naman yung nurturing factor, how you were raised up, how was parenting, how did you live in poverty, and so forth, yung social factors mo. And then, of course, there are also factors which you call predisposing, precipitating, and perpetuating factors. So example ng predisposing, kung nasa community ka where drug abuse is rampant, kahit sa tindahan makakabili ka ng droga, doon ka lumaki, that is a predisposing factor. It can also be a perpetuating factor kasi once na naging drug addict ka na, you still stay in that community, no, magtutuloy-tuloy yung drug addiction mo, no? So next slide, no? But the more, so here, in substance abuse, it's the same. nature would be yung biological na factors, nurture would be yung psychological and social factors, no? And OGK, dinagdag ko na lang yan eh, no? Do you know what OGK stands for? Yung iba alam na ang meaning ng OGK. Only God knows. Ibig sabihin ng OGK. Kasi minsan di mo na masagot eh, no? So, it's OGK, only God knows. No? Next slide. So, here is yung mechanism ng why you become a drug addict. No? So, pinagsama na. At the top, you'll see yung biological factors. No? What you inherited. No? It could be in the biological factors mo, you have a vulnerability, you have a additional mental disorder. No? And then you have, on the other side, yung environment mo. Yung environment mo is basically, yun yung nurture mo eh, how you were raised up in school, how were you parented, yung history mo, childhood history mo, na-abuse ka ba, or ano. And the drugs, no? Kung wala yung drugs, hindi ka magiging drug addict. But if it is available, no? It is cheap, no? And then very early use, brain mechanism, your brain mechanism takes over. So yung mga pathways mo dyan, yung reward pathways, and that leads to addiction. That's how drug addiction is explained in this way. No? Next slide. So, ang the most used na way of explaining drug addiction and even mental disorder is the diathesis stress model. No? Wherein you have vulnerability, nagdaga mo ng stress yan, it leads to a disorder. The one on the top, no? Vulnerability plus stress, it leads to a disorder. Wherein yung vulnerability factors mo are yung biopsychosocial factors. No? Biological, psychological, and social factors yan. No? Okay. So here, next slide, is another presentation. No? So I'm saying vulnerability plus stress equals the disorder. No, sometimes you may not be able to control yung vulnerability mo. But certainly you can manage yung stress mo. So to prevent a disorder, kung hindi mo kaya, let's say ang vulnerability mo is you have the genes for drug addiction. So let's say on your mother's side, merong kang uncle, merong kang dalawang uncle mo that were addicted to drugs, no? And then on your father's side, no, yung lolo mo naging alcoholic, no? And then another uncle was also addicted to marijuana. So chances are merong kang predisposition or you may have inherited the genes which becomes your vulnerability. Now, pwedeng hindi ma-express yan into a disorder if you are able to manage yung stresses mo. No? So this formula is very important. No? So it's because you may not be able to control yung mga vulnerability mo, but certainly you can always manage yung stress mo. Next slide. So, and we know ang chronic stress influences physical and mental well-being. And there are evidences that stress is related to depression, and also depression naman related to sometimes substance abuse, cardiovascular disease, asthma, HIV/AIDS, wound healing, tumor progression, somatic disorders. Merong relationship yan, no, ang stress. No, it is chronic stress, no, has shown to be associated with disease either directly or indirectly. Example ng indirect relationship if you are chronically stressed, and because you're chronically stressed, you cannot sleep. Then you cannot sleep, you start to take alcohol initially, unti-unti lang, no. Later on, kakainin mo ng alak para makatulog. Later on, you develop addiction. So indirectly, yung stress caused yung addiction mo, no. Next slide. Okay. Well, here is just a definition ng stress. Now, ang stress is similar to tension. It's something which you feel na when there is a pressure on you or a demand na something that you have to act on, no, yun ang stress. Pag sinabi mo mang stressor, ito yung mga external event, ito yung mga dahilan kung bakit nagre-react ka or what causes you to have a reaction, no, or to causes you to make an adjustment, no, make an adjustment, no. So yan yung mga sometimes yung stressors, no, sa substance abuse sa treatment are sometimes ginagamit tong nire-replace yung word na stressor as triggers, mga triggers minsan tawag nila diyan, no. So next slide, no. Next slide. So kinds of stressor, maraming klaseng stressor, no. Stressors can be classified in so many ways. Some meron kang acute stress, di ba? And then we in contrast meron kang chronic stress. Meron kang stress that are just normal yung day-to-day na stressors. Pero meron ka ring stressors na what you call traumatic, yung hindi usually na experience mo, talagang life threatening yung ano. But here is another way of classifying yung kinds of stressor. It can be biological, like for example, if you have the flu, the COVID infection, you're pregnant, no? You have to adjust to, may demand sa'yo na dalawa kayo ngayon pinapakain mo. If you have malnutrition, that's biological. Psychological would be yung mga threats, physical harm. Like for example, they found out you have a tumor, nag-biopsy, you're waiting to know whether ano ba to, cancer ba to, malignant or benign. That time, no, period na yun, psychologically you're being stressed, no. Ganun din, waiting for your test result whether you're positive for COVID or not is already psychological. Excessive COVID news din, nanonood ka ng TV, puro COVID ang napapanood mo, it is also psychologically stressing you out. You become more anxious and fearful. That's what happened in 9/11, no. After a week na pinapakita nila sa TV yung paulit-ulit na bumabangga yung eroplano sa ano, they realize that people are being stressed out, no. So they had to stop that media. Now you have also social stressors, no. Dati yung peer pressure, the need to belong to a group, no. Ngayon baliktad eh, no. Social distancing, disrupted yung social support. You have discrimination. These are all forms of social stressor. And then, of course, meron kang environmental stressor, no? Excessive noise, the pollution ng EDSA, no? Economic pressure. Ngayon, may mga bago na. Yung naka-lockdown ka, naka-quarantine ka, immobile ka, hindi ka makalabas, hindi ka magalaw, no? No, these are for all forms of environmental stressors. And then, finally, dinagdag ko na to, COVID stress, I think is all of the above. No, kanya malaking bagay ang COVID stress eh. So next slide, this is a repeat of that slide kanina, and these are some of the reason why nag-worsen ang mental condition, nag-increase ang use of alcohol, tobacco and drugs, no. Kasi if you remember, one of the reason why people take drugs, minsan yung boredom alone. Boredom lang, yung walang ginagawa, no? No, ang problema kasi hindi yung kulang ng time ngayon, minsan ang dami mong time, hindi mo mapasok yung mga bata, nasa bahay ka lang. The boredom alone sometimes triggers people to use alcohol and drugs, no? Next slide. Now, anong major sources of stress? Ang major sources of stress are also coming from the following. It's usually coming from the work. Kung hindi ka naman tatabaho, you're a student, it comes from the school. Or the stressor can come from relationship, in love life mo, relationship with your mom, relationship with your mother-in-law, relationship with your girlfriend, and so forth and so on. Or it can be personal, sarili mo, it comes from you. Like for example, meron kang obsessive compulsive yung traits mo, no, kailangan meticuloso ka, no, that will add up to some of the stress that you have, no. Okay, yan ang major sources. Now let's take a look, next slide. So, from the work, ang usual is work overload. And then usually, time pressure. So, yung time pressure, no, konti nga ang trabaho, pero may deadline na binigay sa'yo. No? So, it becomes a source ng stress. Or interpersonal conflict in the office, no? Or social pressures in the office. No? Okay. Within the family naman, ang the most common, no, which contribute to relapses sa drug abuse, interpersonal conflict and social pressure. Kita mo, social pressure, 20%, no, causes ng relapse. No? Sa mga Pilipino yan, yung the word, aray, makisama ka naman, makisama ka, ganito. It's a big, big word. Eh, no? And then on the personal side, ang malaking cause ng relapses, no, the stress, no, is brought about by negative emotion such as anger, depression, again nandiyan din ang boredom, guilt, shame, no, mga negative emotion are the most common triggers ng sources ng relapse, and it includes even positive feeling, positive ba, yung masyadong masaya, no. And also, 10% ng relapse is due to craving. So, really, when you talk about substance abuse and its treatment, next slide, no? Because of the, yung drug addict mo kasi, usually they sometimes they do na, or most of the time, wala silang work kasi because their time is spent looking for drugs, ang inuuna, or sometimes they spent stealing so that they will have money to look for drugs, no? Yan yung part ng work nila, eh, ng life nila. Eh. And then, instead of love, no, this is replaced by hate, guilt, shame, disgust. Sira yung, ano eh, sira yung relationship part nila eh, with themselves and other people. So, if the relationship with the self is also disturbed, sira, neglected yung self-care. They start to have many health problems like hepatitis, HIV/AIDS, skin problems, and so forth. And then yung love, yung life nila, yung waking, yung sleeping life nila, the spend in bed, no, sira yan. They're more often than not unable to sleep, no, especially kung methamphetamine yan. So the treatment is actually, next slide, is replacing the addictive lifestyle with a healthier lifestyle or less harmful lifestyle, in addition to helping them control their craving and maintain sobriety. No? So, to simplify it, no? Next slide. Now, impact of drug use. No? Okay. Definitely, ang substance use disorder, no? Ang impact niyan is the harm it will cause the health. Yan ang malaking bagay. In addition to that, maraming impact yan eh. No? There are legal implications, there are socioeconomic implications, and many others. Pero ang isang malaking na impact ng drug use is on the health of the person. The health harm it will cause. Next slide. On the next slide, please. On the health harm, no? Hinati ko eh, yung harm on the health eh. Many are medical, surgical problems as a result of substance use disorder. Like for example, many drug addicts, no, dependents, no, develop infectious diseases. Some of them may develop HIV/AIDS, especially yung mga na IV drug users, no, even hepatitis C. And even if you don't have, hindi nagkaroon ng hepatitis, no, you can have fatty liver and all because of the use of drugs, no. But the other health harm is a gamut of mental health problems. Ito yung focus natin ngayon, yung mental health problems. So next slide. So the impact of drug use, no? Substance use disorder can trigger mental disorder. And baliktad naman, mental disorder naman can cause also substance use disorder. So example nung na-trigger ka to develop a mental disorder. Like for example, a young child using marijuana, bata, before age of 18, has been using marijuana. This can trigger a mental disorder in these children who are predisposed. So this is one of the reason na we don't want to pass the law on legalizing marijuana because the effect on children. Di bali sana kung adult where the brain is already well formed, but on children, it can trigger a lot of mental disorders, no? A gamut of mental disorder. Now, an example of mental disorder causing substance abuse. For example, the mental disorder, kanina binigay ko example, is you have insomnia. Hindi ka makatulog, no? So, and you start, because you can't sleep, you started to drink wine. Nag-wine ka, no? So, a glass of wine a night para makatulog ka. And you know, alcohol, may tolerance yan. Later on, dalawang glass nang iniinom niya, no? Later on, isang boteng wine nang iniinom niya para makatulog siya. And then later on, MP lights na lang iniinom niya para mura-mura, no? Isang baso. And then later on, hinebra na. And then later on, he doesn't need to sleep, he just needs to drink and drink, no? Naging substance use, naging alcoholic na siya, substance use disorder. So sometimes the mental disorder can be a depression, malungkot. And as a result of depression, nag-self-medicate siya because marijuana is a euphoric drug substance, no? Causes a feeling of well-being. Nung una, nag-work yun. Nag-work. And you know, marijuana is also a gateway drug, no? And later on, hindi na kaya ng marijuana alone. He has to use cocaine. And then, mahalang cocaine, nag-ship na siya sa methamphetamine. And then becomes substance use disorder na now. So these are the things. Okay, next slide. Why do mental illness and substance abuse co-occur? Bakit ba nagano? Well, nag-occur yung mental illness because sometimes nagsiself-medicate yung mga patients natin, no? And self-medication usually or substance abuse is sometimes resorted to as a means to alleviate yung feelings nila. Let's say, yun nga, na-explain ko kanina, you know, if you have depression, sometimes to alleviate that depression, you use drugs. No? Okay. Yung substance abuse then can also develop mental illness, no? The same way, no? Okay. Causal effect, meaning to say, no, yung substance abuser, there is increases yung vulnerability mo to mental illness, no? Yung sinabi ko kanina, the use ng marijuana at an early age, even the use of alcohol at an early age increases yung vulnerability of children to develop mental disorder. And then common or correlated causes, no, meaning to say, the risk factors for mental illness and substance abuse, no, are basically related or sometimes overlap one another. Okay. So next slide. Okay. Now, there is a term which you call, ito na yung sasagutin natin yung kay question ni Asik Leng kanina, the chicken and the egg, no. Okay. Sometimes mag-uumpisa siya as substance use disorder, and then as a result ng substance use disorder, it causes symptoms of mental disorder. When you have that situation usually madadiagnose siya as substance induced mental disorder. If the substance that is being abused is marijuana, it becomes cannabis induced mental disorder. No, kung halimbawa yung mental disorder result into disturbance ng mood, it will become cannabis induced mood disorders, no? Yun yon na yung substance ang nag-induce ng mental disorders. care, ang usual na chemo dito in treatment, no? Oh, yeah, of course you have to treat both. So usually treat mo. But makikita mo yan once the substance use stops, no? Sometimes or most of the time, yung symptoms din ng mental disorders, no, will stop, no? And usually yung treatment mo, let's say ang nangyari sa iyo, substance induced psychosis, no, nasiraan ng bait, no? No, when you stop the substance that is causing the psychosis, no, mawawala rin yung symptoms ng mental disorder. And the treatment need not be protracted. Yan. Kanya kasi substance use disorder. So next slide, we'll show you a listing. Marami yan yung substance-induced mental disorder. No, nakalist lang dito is just 9, but there are many more. No, so sometimes yung pagka yung persisting amnestic disorder, memory disturbed yan. No, or persisting perceptual disorder, no, nagtutuloy-tuloy, no, but they were induced by the substance, no. Okay, or substance induced sleep disorder, ito, this is common among mga drug dependents na even in recovering, after they recover, wala silang ibang symptoms na natira, but ang nasira is yung sleep nila. They can sleep even if they're not using the drugs anymore. So these are what you call substance induced mental disorder. Okay, next slide. Now, there is a difference kung meron kang mental disorder at the same time and meron ka namang substance use disorder at the same time. Pwede kasing nauna yung mental disorder and then later may substance use disorder ka, which are two separate and distinct na entity. But they both affect one another. In treatment, in rehabilitation, nakaka-affect yun, pareho. So treatment is also directed to both at the same time, no? In this situation, ang lalabas diyan is ang tawag doon is psychiatric comorbidity or what we commonly term as dual diagnosis. Dalawa yung disorder niya. And it's not uncommon, ha? It's not uncommon kasi for mga drug dependents, so it can go, most drug dependents will have at least one serious mental disorder, no? And about 50% plus sa mga drug dependents will have one serious mental disorder. For the alcoholics, at least yan, mga 37% of them or one-third of them will have at least one serious mental disorder, no? And this is what we call yung dual diagnosis or psychiatric comorbidity. So next slide. And most common co-occurring disorder, itong common, no, is usually yung depression, yan, yung major depression. So sandinan, meron siyang major depression, at the same time, substance use disorder. Or it's eating disorder. Bihira ka makakita nito, pero hindi common sa Pilipinas siguro to, no? The first place, parang wala tayong makain masyado, no? And then, personality disorder. This is common. May personality disorder. And at the same time, merong substance use disorder. So, minsan mahirap i-distinguish yung substance-induced na paranoia. No? Substance-induced paranoia. Like for example, yung the use of methamphetamines. No? Nagkaroon ka ng yung paranoia or napraning, no? Sometimes it's difficult to differentiate na meron pala siyang personality disorder na paranoid personality disorder, no? So sometimes different, no? But usually the way to distinguish it is pag nakita mo yung temporal relationship, every time na kagagamit niya ng droga, lumalabas yung symptoms ng paranoia niya, chances are it was induced by the drug. Pero kung miski hindi siya nakadroga, no, paulit-ulit na lumalabas yung tema nung napaparanoid siya, then probably you're dealing with a dual diagnosis. Meron siyang personality disorder separate and distinct from the substance use disorder. And down the line, you can have a combination ng mood, other mood disorders such as bipolar disorder. Anxiety disorder, hindi rin malayo yan. Anxiety disorder is common among substance users din. No? And also PTSD. Next slide. Okay. I think in the last few slides na tayo, why are drug users prone to medical complication and even complication ng mental complications? No? It's because of the direct toxicity of the illicit drug. Dahil toxic yung drug mo kanya, nagkakaroon ng mga medical complications. And it's also behavior associated with drug use. No? Behavior like, for example, IV drug using, you know, nagkakaroon si eventually some of them HIV AIDS, no? Or the socioeconomic disadvantage and poverty endangered life circumstances, like for example, yung poverty, no? Wala silang masyadong pera, wala silang things that they need for work, so they turn on to drugs, no? Or diminished access to effective use of care and disruption of daily routine by active drug user. Because of their active drug use, no, yung wala na sila, hindi nila na-access yung what they should do, like for example, health access to health care, good self care, no, yan yun naman nangyayari. So next slide. So you have harm from all the steps ng drug addiction. So from the time you're trying to get it, from the time you're administering it, from the time you're intoxicated, even withdrawing from it, not, you know, getting out of it, and then withdrawal or getting off it. No? Lahat yan, meron kang danger, meron kang harm. So next slide will show us why. No? So yung acquisition, sometimes pwede kang mag-HIV AIDS. No? Because in acquisition, sometimes it's not money that is used. Sex is sometimes exchanged for drugs, so you can get STD and HIV AIDS. No? And in terms of administering the drug, it will depend on how you administer it. Is it smoked, snorted, ingested, or through injection? So smoking can cause you a respiratory problem. You can have meth mouth, no, or skin problems, no, down the line. So when you're intoxicated, pwede kang ma-accident, pwede kang mag-overdose and die, no? When you're getting off the drug, you can have hangovers, no, like headaches and even insomnia. And then withdrawal, pag nag-withdraw ka from the addiction, you can have morbidities, or if not managed properly, you can even die. So lahat yung stages na yan, merong harm that can happen to you. Next slide. Well, this is the end point naman ng drug addiction. There are only two end points. It's either you die, no? Okay? Or develop psychosis and mental disorder. Usually death, usually either na miscalculate yung dosage, yung binilihan mo, dati mong binibilihan, hinaluan pala ng mga extender yung drugs mo, yung sununod na binilihan mo, puro na yung nabili mo, and then na-overdose ka, na-miscalculate mo yung dosage. Or it's a polydrug use in combination. So the most common na namamatay na unreported is the combination of alcohol and yung benzodiazepine mo. Magandang death dyan kasi hindi ka nalang huminga eh. Parang namatay sa natutulog. But actually, it's depression of the respiration. CNS, depression of respiration. Or after a long abstinence, akala mo, yung dating dose mo, kayang-kaya mo, yung pala, because of the long abstinence, hindi mo na kaya. Or simply, the drugs which you bought were bad drugs. Hindi maganda. Or you can have withdrawal, mismanagement ng withdrawal, no, or treatment, no? Then you die. And then some is talagang nag-suicide na pala, no? Suicide na pala yung ginawa nila, no? And then The second endpoint, kung buhay ka, hindi ka namatay, eventually you will develop psychosis and mental disorder. The longer, the more chronic use, and the more higher ang use mo, the more ka maging prone to mental disorder, especially in psychosis mo. No. I think that's the last slide ko. Next slide. Oh, tapos na. No? That was the last slide. No. I think we have more time ngayon for question and answer.
Maraming salamat, Doc Beng, sa inyong napaka-comprehensive na presentation. Reminder lamang po muli sa ating participants via Facebook live streaming, nakapin po sa comment section ang link sa ating attendance. Please click the link and answer the required information para ma-record po namin ang inyong attendance. So ngayong hapon po, napakarami nating natutunan from understanding how the pandemic causes a stress and how stress impacts the tendency for some persons to use drugs or to relapse. We also learned that substance use disorder is in fact a mental health disorder. Now we are opening the floor for our questions. Sa mga kasama po natin dito sa WebEx, please type your questions dito po sa ating chat box. Sa mga nasa Facebook naman po, please type your questions in the comment section. Doc Beng, kanina po meron nang nag-type ng question while you are presenting. Ang tanong po niya, I think nasagot niyo rin po sa presentation. Sabi po niya, what is the most, mula kay Renz Dave Albay, what is the most common co-occurring disorder among those with SUDs na nabanggit niyo na rin po kanina? Ang related question po dito, siguro i-raise ko na rin po. Ang tanong po is, may factor po ba kung anong type of drug ang ginamit sa posibleng co-occurring mental disorder?
What type of drugs? Huh?
Yes po, may factor daw po ba yun, Doc Benny, sa kung ano yung magiging mental health disorder?
Yes. Like for example, there are drugs that are, tawag nila psychotomimetic. No? It mimics psychosis. So, para siyang schizophrenia ang result. And ang drugs that are commonly that causes this would be basically yung methamphetamine. Cocaine, mga stimulant drugs, no? Especially in high dose, chronic use, no? Ang result niyan, they induce psychotic-like disorders, mental disorders, nagsa-psychosis. So, it can be from mere paranoia, like also yung mga hallucinogens like LSD, no? Ang LSD, ang magiging ang usual niyan is hallucinations, no? It can be vivid visual, no, and even auditory hallucinations.
Thank you, Doc Benny. Another question we have here from a participant. How can you tell if someone has a mental health problem? Meron po ba yung parang signs?
Well, yung mental health problems, di ba? Yung konsepto ng mental health problem. Ang hahanapin mo yung for simplicity's sake, sinabi ko tatlong bagay. Titingnan mo kung meron bang problema yung thinking niya, the way he thinks. No? And this is usually marireflecto dun sa the way he talks or answers you back, no? Meron bang alteration yung mood niya, yung mood, no? Tama lang ba yung mood, adequate, appropriate, o talagang walang-wala na, no, inadequate na o inappropriate na. And then yung behavior, control ng behavior. So yun yung isang konsepto, dapat may alteration ng any of those, no. And then at the same time, it also causes, no, the person to be distressed. Nadi-distress siya, and at the same time, hindi na siya maka-function, may dysfunction. And then it's relatively sustained or recurring. Example, malungkot ang nararamdaman niya, tinding lungkot. As a result ng tinding lungkot niya, hindi na siya makatrabaho. Ayaw na niyang bumangon ng kama, ayaw na niyang mag-report for work. Or ever na pinilit niya yung sarili niya mag-trabaho, wala siyang naisip kundi umiyak, no? Or minsan naisip magpakamatay because distress na siya. So it has to have yung elements na yon. Significant alteration ng thinking, mood, or behavior. Tapos na at the same time, it causes distress, dysfunction, and sustain or recurrence.
So,
kanya yung single drug use, hindi mo masabi na minsan lang siya gumamit. No, hindi mo pa masabing a disorder kagad yun eh. No, kung recurrence siya, paulit-ulit, yan. And nakita mo talagang nagiging na-apektuhan yung trabaho niya, yan.
Siguro, Doc Benny, that answers din yung isang related question no, na parang paano daw ma-differentiate yung mental health disorder kung yung nagka-problema ka lang, kaya ka parang nagkakaroon ng mga changes dun sa binanggit niyo po ng mga behavior.
Oh, pag may problema ka, may problema ka lang, eh, lahat naman, usually mental disorder, meron din sa problema. Ang question din, yung nakakapagtrabaho ka pa ba, in spite of that problem, nakakapagtrabaho ka pa ba? In spite of that problem, no, you're still able to relate with other people. No? In spite of that problem ba, no, you're able to tolerate it. No? Yun ang mga easy dyan. Pero kung hindi mo na matolerate, no, so meron ng distress. No? Hindi mo na matolerate. Minsan naisip na, magpakamatay na lang ko dahil dito sa problema to. No? Nahirapan ka na. I want to end it all. And then at the same time, because of that problem, hindi ka na rin nakakapagtrabaho, then that's, isipin mo na yan, this may be already a mental disorder. And then yung duration. Kung isang araw lang yan, dalawang araw, tas then after 2 days, maayos ka na ulit, then that's not a problem. No?
Thank you, Doc Benny. Isa pa pong tanong natin from a participant. Is personality problem the same with mental health problem?
Okay. Pag nilagay mo yung word na mental health problem, hindi siya disorder, ha? Hindi, it's not a disorder. Pag sinabi mental disorder, yun, sakit yun. Pero kasi maraming mental health problems tayo. Yun lang COVID ngayon. That's a mental health problem for us. Yung worry and fears, no? So, ano yung question niya? Yung personality. Personality disorder yan, no? Pag sinabi mo, ang trait lang, trait. Ibig sabihin, characteristic lang pa disorder. Pero pag nilagay mo yung word sa end, disorder, it means merong distress yan. Merong nagkukos na yung personality niya causes a dysfunction. So, pwedeng hindi siya mag-last sa trabaho because of the personality type niya, pirmi siyang natatanggal sa trabaho o nagre-resign siya. Yan. Hindi siya makatrabaho. He becomes non-productive siya and nadidistress siya. Or if not, kung hindi siyang nadidistress, kasi meron kayong antisocial personality disorder. Eh, no? Ang nadidistress dun sa antisocial personality disorder are the people around them. No, yung the person may not be even aware na meron siyang disorder minsan.
Thank you, Doc Benny. Another question po from a participant. What drug or therapy is good for those with mental health condition?
Okay. Many of the treatment ngayon is a combination, no? Pharmacotherapy plus talk therapy. Yun ang usual na combination, the most common na treatment, no? There are some mga mental disorder na you don't need to take drugs, no? Ano ka lang, no? Talk therapy lang, no? And there are certain mental conditions naman na you may only need drugs, hindi mo na kailangan talk therapy, no? So, but many is a combination. Dalawang yun. And then there are many types sa gamot mo, maraming types of medicines. You can have antidepressant, antipsychotic, anti-anxiety, no? A whole gamut of medicines na meron ka. Doon naman sa talk therapy mo, yung psychotherapy, counseling, maraming klase yan, from cognitive behavior to psychoanalytic and down the line. Supportive, maraming klase. No, it's happening. And then, in addition sa mga individual, pero ngayon, wala ngayon gumagawa ngayon because of COVID, yung mga group therapy, group sessions, no, nawala lahat ngayon yan. No?
Thank you, Doc Benny. There are some questions pa po from our participants here on WebEx. Mula po kay Renz Dave Albay, ang tanong po niya, would co-occurring disorders make prognosis poorer for those with substance use disorder?
Oh, definitely. The prognosis is poorer. Treatment becomes more difficult. Treatment becomes more expensive. You will need additional professionals na to treat yung especially the mental health conditions. And you know very well na yung mga psychiatrists, psychologists, konti lang yan sa Pilipinas eh. Hindi rin marami. No? So that adds up to yung that adds up to the poorer prognosis.
Alright, sige po. Let's take up more questions pa po from our participants. From our Deputy Executive Director for Administration, ang tanong po niya, what is the best intervention for COVID depression sometimes leading to suicide?
Okay, so COVID depression and suicide, no? Malamang yon, the COVID actually was a trigger to depression and then yung suicide, no? Wala pa tayong nakita yung talagang direct relation as a result ng COVID ganito, yun ang naging nag-cause ng depression. Probably, chances are, meron na siyang vulnerable na siya to depression, nadagdag lang yung stress ng COVID, and that's why nagtuloy-tuloy yung disorder niya ng major depression. So, major depression and treatment, the best would be a combination, ito ay classic example, combination ng medications, no, pharmacotherapy, antidepressant, and talk therapy. Nakausap mo yan. No, so yun ang the best na treatment doon. Yung suicide is another story. Kung hindi namatay, no, yung suicide na yun, you have to discuss that, no. No, kung like now ang mangyayari diyan, you get the support ng family to watch over yung patient mo regarding yung suicide, no? Okay? So, to prevent yung suicide until yung medication mo. Kasi yung antidepressant are slow medications, no? It's not like a magic pill. Pag binigay mo, magaling kagad sila. It takes about 3 or 4 weeks before yung depression will lift from yung mga antidepressant na treatment. Generally, minsan, with antidepressant treatment alone, antidepressant, no? 60% to 80% will get well. Wala pa yung talk therapy mo, ha? Antidepressant treatment lang. No. Malaki na kagad yung improvement. No?
Thank you, Doc. Now, ito po, interesting question din po from one of our participants, from Sandy June Peralta. Ang tanong po niya is, how do we deal with clients with mental health disorder if we are not equipped to treat them? Do we have a referral system for this?
Yeah, referral ang gagawin mo. If you're not equipped with it, referral. You do a referral, no? Let's say, for example, depression. Depression, sometimes, yung iba, some counselors will try muna yung talk therapy, no? But after 2-3 weeks na hindi nag-improve, they usually now refer, no? O kaya, let's say, suicidal yung pasyente mo, yung kliyente mo is suicidal, and then you assess yung suicidality niya, and you feel na after assessment hindi naman imminent yung suicide, you can still do counseling, no? Counseling, no? Pero kung hindi nag-improve after a week or two, then make a referral for the suicide niya, no? Pero kung talagang man suicidal na, imminently suicidal, make a referral. One thing you can do is don't keep it as a secret. Kung meron siya mga father, mother, father, or husband, or wife, no? You ask, you engage the help of the support system. Kasi pag ikaw naman, hindi mo naman masusubaybayan yan. Lalo na ngayon, ang the most common style ng treatment natin ngayon, hindi na nag-face-to-face, bihira yung nag-face-to-face ngayon. No? There are many doctors, no, and psychiatrists na nag-phone counseling na lang instead of doing face-to-face na treatment. So mahirap din yung phone counseling eh.
Thank you, Doc Benny. Another question po here from WebEx, and then we'll raise the concerns po ng mga participants natin via Facebook Live. Isang question po, Doc Benny, from Precious Marie Bulan. Are there medical conditions that has symptoms like mood disorders or changes?
Medical conditions, no? Yeah, meron yan.
Yung mental health disorder.
Yes. Example of this is in thyroid. Thyroid medical conditions that hyperthyroid ka. When you have hyperthyroid, no? And chances are you will have anxiety. Tataas yung level ng anxiety na. So aside from yung basal metabolic rate matataas, yung heart rate mo, yung pulse rate mo mataas, anxious ka din, hyper yung tao. Baliktad din, pagka naman hypothyroid, no, kulang sa hormone, it can manifest as depression. Parang mabagal kumilos, nalulungkot siya, ganun. So minsan, sabihin mo, depression yan, no, depression. No? Ganun din, in the elderly, pwede kang meron ka ng medical condition akala mo naman it's a Alzheimer's or a neurological condition. Yung pala, it is a depression mimicking a mental condition. And then the other way around, maraming sitwasyon na ganyan eh. Like GERD. Ang GERD naman yung can be actually a physical disorder na mismo, GERD, because meron kang problema dun sa anatomy ng stomach mo and in esophagus mo, no? Or sometimes, because of anxiety, nagmamanifest siya as parang GERD, no? So, minsan, mahirap i-distinguish yung medical sa purely psychiatric. Sometimes, it's a combination.
In that regard po, Doc Benny, no, importante talaga na meron pong mag-diagnose na professional, no? Hindi tayo nagsi-self-diagnose din dahil hindi natin nga po
alam. Yeah. Minsan mahirap yung minsan nagbabasa ka lang ng internet at nagda-diagnose ka ng sarili mo, mahirap yun. Pag if it's really a problem, you seek professional help.
Yes, thank you, Doc Benny. Now, meron pong mga questions din from Facebook mula sa ating mga viewers from our Facebook live streaming. Mula po kay Bleselda San Jose Mangkoy. Ang question po niya is tungkol sa inhalant. Sabi niya, ano ba ang totoo? Kasi may nabasa po ako na ang inhalant is a drug, pero sa ibang reference, inhalant is a toxin and poison at hindi daw po drug. Can you clarify that, Dr. Benny?
Well, the common solvent na ina-abuse in the street, like yung ini-inhale nila na glue, no? This is really toxic. Hindi lang glue. Some people inhale yung amoy ng gasolina, gasoline or even kerosene. Ini-inhale yan. No, for those of that yung mag-inhale ng glue, no. These are really toxic. Nasisira yung liver, at the same time the brains na nasisira yung brain, and sometimes the damage are permanent. Hindi mo na ma-reverse, no? Yung other inhalant, it will depend on yung ini-inhale mo, no? Some may not be damaging, pero kung mga yung substances that are usually found, yung ginagamit ng mga street kids natin, like glue, toluene, di ba? No? Kerosene, no? Gasoline, yun ang ini-sniff mo. It can have damaging effect and even sometimes permanent yung effect niya.
Thank you, Doc Benny. At siguro to clarify din po, no, kasi ang Dangerous Drugs Board po has a regulation then that classified yung mga inhalants, yung mga toluene-based inhalants as a dangerous drugs kung wala sila nung at least 5% na mustard oil kasi nga po ito ay inaabuso. So there's a regulation na po na nilabas ng Dangerous Drugs Board regarding that. So classified po siya as a dangerous drugs. More questions, Doc Benny, from our Facebook participants mula kay Icon Ruiz. Ang sabi po niya, there are psychotic drugs that cannot be brought at Mercury or drugstore, only at the National Center for Mental Health. How can you control their behavior during this pandemic, especially if this is a maintenance drug during the time of quarantine? So mabibili lang daw po sa NCMA. So paano po kaya makaka-access yung mga may kailangan nitong mga medications na ito?
Well, that's really one of the problem brought about by the pandemic. Why mental condition worsens, why substance abuse worsens then, and other chronic medical condition nag-worsen is simply because, one, yung mga doktor na magpapa-check up ka, minsan, some of them are not practicing. Hindi na nagpe-face-to-face consultation. Or just simply stop practicing muna. No? Natakot sila, baka mahawa sila. So, yung access to care, naging problema na. Pangalawa, yung mga manufacturing companies, yung mga drug companies, no? Hindi lahat nag-shutdown yung iba. So they cannot manufacture all the medicine and provide the medicine. Kanya minsan, wala kang mabilis sa mercury. No? So minsan, ang nangyayari is you call from one mercury drugstore to another mercury drugstore. Ang mga drugstore, hahanapin mo kung nasan yung merong supply. No? Well, it's not true na lahat lang nasa mental. In fact, at NCMH, minsan I have patients na hindi rin makabili sa NCMH. Eh. No? So sa mga drugstore talaga kabibili. So that's really a problem ngayon, no? Well, ang mga antipsychotics, no, you consult a doctor, no? Kasi kung if you have an antipsychotics that's not available, yung brand na yon, I'm sure there are other antipsychotics, no, kapamilya ng drug na yon, which can be used to replace, no? Now there are doctors na especially nung height nung quarantine natin, there were many psychiatrists and doctors then that went online telephone counseling and gave their services for free. So some of them would just simply ask, ano ba yung dating piniprescribe ng doktor sa iyo, no? Kung hindi ka makakuha niyan, I'll issue. Pwede na kasi yung e-prescription eh. An e-prescription for those medicine. So, just to tidy you up for a month or two hanggang mag-practice uli yung doktor mo, bumalik ka sa doktor mo. Meron mga doktor na ganun ang ginawa, giving their services for free. No? Pero ngayon, meron din mga nagtuloy na doktor ngayon na who are now telephone counseling, they also charge na. No? So, I think it's still a problem yung mga gamot, no? So, you consult kasi I'm sure there are other brands na pwede mo. Some of them may be a little bit more expensive, pero you can ship to other brands na pwede. That has similar effect.
Thank you, Doc. Siguro po, ibalita rin po namin mula sa Dangerous Drugs Board po kasi po, during the pandemic, naglabas din po tayo ng advisory na pwede nga pong ialawang e-prescription or electronic prescription. Yeah. So, ipapakita lang po yung photo ng prescription. Yeah. At yan po ay valid po until ma-lift yung public health emergency. So hanggang ngayon po, pwede pa rin po yan tanggapin yung ating electronic prescription. Meron pa pong mga tanong from Facebook, Doc Benny, mula po kay R&D Fernando. Ang tanong po niya is, are there other organic meds to address anxiety so as not to use psychotropic meds? Related question din po yung mula kay Abel Rivera na, can mindfulness meditation exchange for CBT? Ang tanong, ang sabi po nila.
Yes. Organic medicines for anxiety disorder. Uh, wala ata akong alam ngayon ng ganun eh, organic na medicine. Medyo siguro yung mga calming tea, like chamomile tea, no? Siguro yan ang mga yan ang pwede mong gamitin. Usually, yung anxiety mo can be treated in two ways, no? Pwede ka, one way is through biochemical, mga gamot yan. And the other one is purely non-biochemical. So, in anxiety, no, you can be taught relaxation techniques, no? You can be taught mindfulness, no? And even before mindfulness, no, if you want to switch yung anxiety mo, you can train your brain to switch off yung becoming so anxious and thinking so much through meditation. Kasi meditation is one stage yan before you go to mindfulness, no? Okay. And it can replace cognitive behavior therapy, CBT mo, no? Pwede replacement yan, no? Okay. And the other one is pwede kang biochemical, no? Ang anxiety mo can be treated using antidepressant then, because many antidepressants have anti-anxiety effects. Some antipsychotic medicines, if given at low dosages, has anti-anxiety properties also. Pwedeng combination yan. And the other one is actually used ng mga benzodiazepine, kasi anxiolytics yan eh, mga benzodiazepines. No? Ang problem lang yung benzodiazepines mo, meron siyang habituating effect. Pwede kang ma-hooked on it. So if you have a vulnerability for drug addiction, like for example, nakita mo na sa pamilya nyo, meron kayong tendency na maging alcoholic, maybe you don't use that. Stay away from it. No, use other drugs, other medicine. Na walang withdrawal, walang habituating potential. But we've seen many people na treating their anxiety with mga anxiolytics din na that do not get addicted to it. So, or you can have a combination of both. In some cases, like for example, panic attacks. No? If the panic attacks are not too crippling, no, or it's crippling, but it doesn't occur na madalas na madalas, no? Once every week lang or once every a month lang nangyayari, no? It's sometimes good enough that the person knows na meron siyang a tablet for panic na nasa wallet niya. So sometimes hindi na niya nagagamit 'yon, just the reassurance na meron siya nung gamot na 'yon he can take in times ng panic is well enough. Nasa-serve nila yung panic nila. Na they overcome their panic without using the drugs.
Thank you, Doc Benny. More questions pa po from Bianca Maisog. What advice can you give to health professionals when prescribing or dispensing marijuana if the law on medical use of marijuana will be approved? Naku, wala pa nga pong law. Can we answer that, Doc Benny? Or
yes, walang there is no doctor who will prescribe marijuana. Wala. Even in the States, yung law nila, the medical societies don't refuse to prescribe marijuana. So ang the most na naginagawa in the countries na approve yung marijuana, no, is the doctor can just give a recommendation or a certification that marijuana may help that person, and then that person carries that letter and goes to a dispensing center where it is dispensed. So palagay ko baka yung sa atin din, if it will be passed into law, ganun din. Hindi for one, our PMA, Philippine Medical Association, the Philippine Psychiatric, and many of the professional medical associations are against the legalization ng marijuana. No. So ganun din mangyayari, no doctor will be prescribing it.
Thank you, Doc Benny. Meron din pong tanong from Edel Pamela Miro. Ang tanong po niya is, may mental disorder ba na nag-o-occur related to withdrawal of drug use?
Yes, yes. So, yung sinabi ko sa a while ago, di ba? You can have a substance-induced withdrawal state. No? As well as substance-induced, yung intoxication. So, withdrawal can ano, like for example, in alcohol withdrawal, the alcoholic, when they withdraw, develops a disorder pag hindi na managed properly, which you call delirium tremens. So in delirium tremens, no, so you have profuse perspiration, tremens, meaning nagtetremor siya. In addition to that, may mga psychiatric symptoms. Nagkakaroon silang hallucinations, no? Vivid visual hallucinations, delusions, no? They become incoherent and irrelevant, parang psychosis din, no? And this is because of withdrawal, no? So, well, there are some drugs na hindi ganoon naman ng hindi ka nagkakaroon ng ganung katinding ano. Like for example, in marijuana, hindi expected na magkakaroon ka ng withdrawal that will require medical attention. Or even in methamphetamine, yung withdrawal need not always be in a medical setting. Unlike alcohol, heroin, you need to withdraw them in a medical setting. So minsan yung iba niyan kailangan mag-IV ka, monitoring on a day-to-day basis hanggang matapos yung withdrawal.
Thank you, Doc Benny. Meron naman po tayong tanong dito from Joseph De Luna. Ang tanong po niya is, kapag ang tamang treatment sa drug user ay or drug dependent ay naibigay, gaano katagal siya gagaling o makaka-recover? 9 months daw po ba? 12 months? Or 1 year?
Walang single, as I've said, there is no single formula to that fits all. It is going to be tailored fit. Pero yung mga programs natin, no, meron siyang duration. So like for example, in our law, if your residential treatment is usually 6 months, no less than 6 months to about 1 year. Naka-prescribe kasi yun under law, pero that is not a hard and fast rule. So or let's say you finish yung residential treatment mo, nag-six months ka, tapos pinalabas ka na. Under our law, meron ka naman tinatawag na you should be in aftercare, di ba? And the aftercare is usually 18 months. Pero after, let's say, 6 months, magaling ka na, tinutuloy mo na lang yung aftercare kasi because the law prescribes na 18 months ka eh. No? Pero in 6 months, magaling ka na. No? But generally, ang concept ng recovery, no, it's a lifelong process. Eh. You do not lower your guard, no, pagka nagre-recover ka. Most recovering addicts will know, nagre-recover, they continually sila they're recovering, no, lifelong, no. It's a lifestyle recovery. Maintaining a healthy lifestyle.
Thank you for that information, Doc Benny. Isa pa pong tanong from Christy Almoguera Samson. Kapag po ba nagamot ang mental disorder, may tendency pa po ba itong bumalik pagkalipas ng maraming taon?
Some are recurring. Some are single lang. For example, yung schizophrenia, some may have only one episode and then after that episode, hindi na umulit. No, and some naman have one episode ng schizophrenia and then hindi fully recovered but they are actually well. Some may have a single episode ng depression and then hindi na umulit. And some naman nagiging paulit-ulit. The formula which I said a while ago, di ba? You have a vulnerability plus stress and then disorder, no? Yung stress dun sa formula, yun ang hindi mo ma-predict. Halimbawa ngayon, you had the mental disorder, no? And you got treated. Let's say major depression, you got treated. Hindi mo ma-predict from now up to 5 years from now, what are your stresses that are going to be? Hindi mo alam kung hihiwalayin ka ng asawa mo after 3 years, o kaya mamamatay ang asawa mo after 3 years. Hindi, you can predict it. And those period na yon of stress can again trigger or make yung disorder mo manifest again. So that's why, sabi ko kanina dun sa formula natin, oh, you may not be able to manage yung vulnerability mo, pero it's important that you're able to handle or manage yung stress mo, no? Because that will spell the difference whether you will have a relapse, whether you will uulit yung sakit mo o hindi, no? So very important that you're able to manage yung stresses mo.
Thank you, Doc. That's a very good reminder po. Now, balikan lang po natin yung ilang tanong pa ng ating participants dito sa WebEx. From Joanne, how can we categorize a person to be considered as an alcoholic individual?
Well, alcoholic, it's like drug addiction din. Similar din yung diagnosis ng ano. So, in alcoholism, meron kang, of course, yung behavior, yung drinking alcohol, repetitive, paulit-ulit, inom ng inom. So again, you go by yung mga criteria, meron bang tolerance, no? Kung meron siyang tolerance, ibig sabihin, increasing yung dose, kailangan itaas, tumataas yung dose niya. Two, pag natigil yung gamot, do you have symptoms of withdrawal, no? Three, yung drug-taking behavior niya is already affecting yung work, affecting yung relationship niya, no? Affecting even the relationship of that person to himself, no? So pag ganun na yung sistema, no, then you have alcoholism, which is a drug addiction. So kailangan mapakita mo yun, withdrawal, tolerance, tapos dysfunction, distress, yun mga yun. Repetitive siya, behavior, paulit-ulit, no? The very definition ng mental disorder din apply mo rin.
Alright, another question po from Melowin Gala. Good afternoon, Doc. What causes pseudo-bulbar effect and what is the treatment for it?
Pseudo-bulbar effect, hindi ko ata masagot yun. That's one question na hindi ko masagot. No? I'll research on it. Ano yung pangalan niya?
Yes, sige po. Pwede po nating balikan yan yung tanong galing sa Halloween.
At least meron ako isang hindi masagot, ha?
Sige po.
99 na lang ang grade ko.
Yes, Doc. Sige po. We'll take up siguro po a few more questions. Mga 2 to 3 questions po from our participants. Ito po ang isang tanong, Doc Benny. In your experience as the chief of the National Center for Mental Health, can you share po kung gaano karami sa mga nasa facility ay dahil sa substance use? May mga gumagaling po ba dito?
Konti lang naman, hindi naman marami. Number one, pinakamarami would be schizophrenic, followed by the bipolar disorder, major depression, and then yung substance-induced psychosis. Yan ang pang number 4 siguro. As I've said, yung mga substance-induced psychosis, sometimes, pag naka-confine lang sila, and then the environment is controlled, walang drugs na magte-take, merely stopping the drugs, nag-abate din yung symptoms. Nawawala din yung symptoms. And it's speeded up, napapabilis pa siya if you give, let's say, psychosis siya, antipsychotic medication. No? And then they go out, maayos na sila. Some of them learn their lesson. No, yung iba, natakot na because of using the drug, gaganto pala ako, don't use the drug anymore. No, and then they get well. Pero yung mga meron ng mental disorder, let's say for example, to begin with, they have already schizophrenia, and they started to take drugs. No, the drugs aggravated yung condition nilang schizophrenia. No, naging florid na florid yung symptoms nila, no? So even if you take away the drugs, no, this schizophrenia nila may still continue. And you will need continuous treatment for them. No. Yung cure kasi, many have a misnotion ng cure, eh, no? And treatment, no. Ang alam lang treatment, gagaling ka na. There are many illness. Now, there is no complete cure. Example would be hypertension. Pag may hypertension ka na, you can treat the hypertension with antihypertensive medicine. But it doesn't mean when you stop yung medication mo, hindi na babalik yung hypertension mo. Some you need maintenance. Ganun din. If you're diagnosed to have diabetes, no, people with diabetes, no, talagang clear yung diagnosis, no, need to have maintenance treatment. Even if they get yung blood sugar nila low na, maganda na, it doesn't mean they have to stop. You have to continue. Many heart conditions are like this. Continuous yung treatment mo, you don't stop. Meron ka maintenance. The same is true with many types of mental disorders. No? Minsan, you don't, like for example, in some schizophrenic patients, no, you don't stop medication, continuous lang yung maintenance medication. Otherwise, nagre-relapse sila. So, minsan ganun. No? Meron din naman na, no? Na one episode, they get well, di na umulit.
Thank you, Doc. From Sandy Jude Peralta po, for depression in bipolar disorder, is antidepressants prescribed?
Yes, pre-prescribed din yan. Especially kung halimbawa, the depression is accompanied by high suicidality. Magagamble ka na magbigay ng antidepressant. But antidepressant in bipolar disorder, minsan, it triggers yung mania. No, nagme-mania eh. Kanya, many psychiatrists are cautious in using yung antidepressant for patients with bipolar disorder. And generally, nire-reserve nila kung talaga yung depression talaga is likely na the reason for suicide attempts. No? Yun ang minsan na ginagawa nila. No. Kasi in bipolar disorder, mas better is to control the shifts in mood using a mood stabilizer rather than i-treat mo yung depression pag nag-go down siya. Kasi minsan nati-trigger palalo yung bipolarity o yung mania niya with the antidepressant. But there are some psychiatrists na will use antidepressant. Minsan pinagsasabay yung gamot na yun.
Now, Doc Benny from Rens Dave Albay, meron pa po siyang isang tanong. How do we deal if there is a secondary gain motive for the patient's psychiatric symptoms?
Oh. Yeah, pwede yan. Merong psychiatric gains, no? Makikita mo yan kung, halimbawa, for example, merong it is involved sa lawsuit or kailangan siya sa, let's say, we're seeing this sa mga veterans eh, no? That when they have naging severe yung mental disorder nila, yung disability or medical benefits nila, no, becomes nag, kung let's say they're given only 60%, nagwa 100%, no? So some of them intentionally nang papa-admit sa psychiatric facility, may secondary gain, no? So, i-discharge mo less than a week, no? Pero, kasi dahil yung disability na magtataas lang na ano, they want to extend. Yung ano. So, minsan merong ganun. So, nangyayari. Or, for example, the other one is, the secondary gain is para to avoid the legal cases, di ba? So, ginamit niya na insanity defense. Kanya ako nagawa yung crime na yun because I was insane. Magkukunwari siya ng insanity. So, merong mga ganung cases, no? But usually, nahuhuli to eh. Malalaman mo rin kung whether niloloko ka lang ng patient mo or not, no? So if you interview them over a period of time, yung symptoms are usually consistent yan over time for a particular disorder. Kung pabago-bago, on the next interview iba, on the next interview iba, you will know na, ate ka muna, merong niloloko tayo nito, no? And then you look for anong magigain niya. That's the secondary gain. Like for example, ngayon maraming pwedeng mangyari yan kasi ngayon walang face-to-face counseling. Pag over the telephone counseling ka lang, yan ang yun minsan mahirap ma-spot yan.
Thank you. Sige po, last three questions po, given our time na rin po. This is from Delia Henyo from Facebook. Sa inyo pong observation as medical expert, gaano po kalaking porsyento ang naitutulong sa mga drug victims when they began to attend spiritual counseling or values formation activities?
Well, I can't give the percent, no? But spirituality is now being used in the treatment ng substance use disorder, and they're also relatively effective. Ang the interventions that you make for a drug dependent, no, hindi mo ma-measure yung percent na itong family counseling na to is about 10% nito. Itong individual session with me is about 60%. Itong spiritual counseling to gives you 30. Ang hirap, wala tayong data that eases that out, no? But we know, ang what we know is that you tailor fit yung treatment and the modality that treatment mo, tina-tailor fit mo to the needs of your patient. So may mga pasyente na ayaw nila yung spiritual kasi nakukornehan daw sila, ganito, nanabubor sila, lalo silang nagagalit pag naririnig nila o naalala nila yung tatay nila, parang yung tatay ko lang yung ano, na lalo kong na-iste. So maybe that will not be the prescription for that patient. Or if ever na prescribe mo, if you want to give a percent, baka 5% lang siya or what. I don't know how you will measure it. Hindi mo measure na concretely yung mga ano, intervention. What we know of are programs, yung mga gawang programs can be measured in terms of, no, ganong karami bang gumagaling, and then yung relapse rate. Ilan na nagre-relapse after the treatment nila. Yun ang usual na measure. So let's say you have a program, no, wherein dinaan mo 100 substance abuser, how many of them napagaling mo after a given period of time? And how many of those na gumaling na, no, given a this program, ang nag-relapse, no, yung relapse rate. Okay, and even sometimes you can measure the program in terms of capacity of the program to retain them in treatment. Yan ang usual na ginagamit mo measure for programs. But now, ang programs mo, from one program to another program, ng drug treatment na program, iba-iba yan. Depende dun sa experience ng grupo. So that's why you have, meron kang faith-based. So the faith-based doesn't mean puro spiritual lang yan. It means only a predominance of that intervention, no. Meron namang mga hindi faith-based, no. It depends, iba-iba. Siguro yun yung mga pwede mong i-measure if you want to compare them.
Thank you, Doc Benny. Sabi ko po kanina last three questions, pero may pumasok po isang question. Siguro po sagutin muna natin before our last two questions. Okay lang po ba, Doc Benny?
Sige.
Love po from Melwin Galla. What drugs can cause permanent psychosis? Meron po bang ganun, Doc Benny?
What drugs can cause permanent psychosis?
possibly alcohol is one, no? Pwede kang magkaroon ng permanent alcohol hallucinosis. Alcohol, especially mismanaged yung withdrawal niya, can sometimes, hindi lang psychosis ang nangyayari, but permanent damage sa memory, no? Memory damages, no? Okay. And then, ano ba, drugs like in nabanggit ko kanina, like for example, yung mga toluene, yung mga solvents, no? Yan, they can cause permanent damage sa brain. Ang almost any drug can cause permanent damage, especially if taken at very high dose and chronically mong ginamit. Matagal na matagal mong ginagamit. And then, ano. Pero kung hindi naman, no, the brain can sometimes recover. Actually, the brain recovers. Recovers. Ngayon na, meron na tayong mga diagnostic for that. Meron na tayong CT scanning. No, CT scan, PET scan, no, MRI, no, you can show yung progress ng brain. No?
Thank you, Doc. Magandang reminder po yan. Magandang paalala sa ating participants. No? Last two questions na po. Itong first question ay dalawang related questions mula po sa ating participant from Facebook. Ang una po is, we know that substance-induced mental disorder must be addressed by psychiatrists and health workers. But as individuals or friends to a person who use drugs, can we do something to help them? At related question din po dyan mula kay Alberta Belaong, can you give tips on how we can extend help to people on mental stress or discomfort in a healthy way, especially now that we are on fear of COVID-19?
So yung una muna, yung a person na merong psychosis ba yun, tanong niya? No?
A person who use drug po.
Who use drugs.
Merong mental disorder. Paano po matutulungan?
Tapos merong mental disorder. Well, referral lang usual dyan eh. Sometimes there is a need to confront them of their problem and then simply telling them face to face na maybe you need ano, you need to be referred to be seen by somebody. Yun ang isa doon na pwede mong gawin yun. No? Ang maganda dyan is lalo na kung solicited na advice ang hiningi sa'yo. Nagtanong yung friend mo, ano bang pwede kong gawin? Yun, magandang tiyempo yun na sabihan mo. You can seek professional help. I know somebody who can help you. No? Just talk about it lang muna. Ganun, yun ang isa. Ano yung isang question ng isa?
Ang tanong din po is, mga tips on how we can extend help to people on mental stress or discomfort.
Okay. So, basically, no, ang nire-recommend, walang gamot, no. Ang usual na recommendation for people who have yung mga mental health problems nagkakaroon ng or stress out. One, unang-una, keep connected. Huwag kang mag-isolate, no. Keep in touch and you maintain yung social support mo, either family or friends. Kasi ang social support will always buffer the effect of stress. Kahit saan yan, sigurado yan. So, keeping connected. Kung hindi ka makakonect ngayon dahil simply because meron tayong problem with COVID, bawal na yung mga parties, bawal yung ano, at least sa social media, calling them on telephone, merong Viber, no, texting them, no, keep connected, no. Maganda niyan if you have a friend na confident mo, na nakakakwentuhan mo, yan. That's number one advice, no? No? The second advice is keep moving. Kailangan active ka. So yung iba kasi, in addition to mag-a-isolate, magkukulong sa kwarto, no? Kakalimutan na nila yung ginagawa nila. So keep moving. If you're doing exercise dati, mag-exercise ka. Kung meron kang routine sa trabaho na disrupt, try to keep that routine kasi pag nawalan ka ng routine yung stress mo nandoon eh, no, So very important yon. So social connectedness, keep moving, no? Yung healthy lifestyle mo, i-continue mo yung healthy lifestyle mo, no? Get sunlight every day, no? At least magkaroon ka ng sunlight. Have manage yung time mo, you have to manage your time in such a way that there is time for sleeping and resting and relaxation. Kailangan yan. Ngayon, ang maraming natitrigger to depression, anxiety, panic, is simply because disturbed lang yung sleep. Iba dun sa pie na pinakita ko, no? Imagine, 1/3 of your life is spent in bed sleeping. Very important. So, kung kulang lang yung 7 hours, 8 hours, let's see, 4 na oras, 5 oras ka lang nakakatulog, no? It will take its toll on you. So, kailangan mag-schedule ka, no? A lot of time for sleeping, relaxation, and recreation, no? And then, isa pang pwede mong gawin is you can make a list of things that will make you happy or will help you, no, in times of stress, and try to force yourself to do it. No? Minsan ganun kailangan eh, pinipwersa mo yung sarili mo to do it. No? I think yun lang mga yan, marami na may tutulong sa kanila. There are many more, marami pa. No? Meditation, relaxation exercises, autogenics, visualization, there are many techniques na pwede mong gamitin pa eh. No? But yun ang number one, yung staying connected, keep moving, no? Healthy lifestyle, yan.
Thank you po, Doc Benny. Magandang mga tips po yan. No? So keep connected, keep moving, maintaining healthy lifestyle, and managing your time. Maraming salamat po, Doc Benny. I think we have exhausted our time for the question and answer. At naging mas malalim po ang ating mga naging usapan dahil sa inyong mga katanungan. So maraming salamat po sa ating resource speaker, Dr. Benny Vicente, and of course sa atin rin po mga participants. Kung may mga tanong po kami na hindi nasagot, sisikapin po namin i-address po rin ito. Opo, ang mga sagot po ay ipopost natin sa official Facebook page ng Dangerous Drugs Board. Para naman po sa kopya ng presentation, maaari po ninyo itong i-access sa pamamagitan ng link na nakapost po sa chat box dito sa WebEx. Ipopost din po yan sa comment section sa Facebook. Nais ko rin pong hilingin sa inyong lahat na sagutan ng ating evaluation form. Ang link po ay ipopost dito sa WebEx at Facebook. Makakatulong po ito ang inyong mga responses sa evaluation para mas mapaganda pa natin yung ating susunod na webinar. Muli po, maraming salamat sa inyong lahat, sa lahat ng nakasama natin ngayong hapon, lalong-lalo na po sa ating resource person, Dr. Benny Vicente. Ganoon na rin po sa ating Deputy Executive Director for Operations, ASEC Maria Belen Angelita Matibag. Maraming salamat po sa lahat ng tumutok sa ating programa sa pamamagitan ng Facebook. Continue tuning in to the official social media accounts of the Dangerous Drugs Board for announcements on upcoming activities and events. We are on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Hanapin nyo lamang po ang DDBGov, that's DDBGOV. Hanggang sa muli po, enjoy the rest of the day, and please continue to stay safe and healthy. Maraming salamat po sa inyong lahat.
Sa pagdawa ay gamitin sa paglipa ng mga panukala. Ikalang kabatiran, laban at tunasan.